This episode of Linux Action Show is brought to you by GoDaddy.com.
And by Ting.com. Head over to last.ting.com and save $25 off your first device.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Linux Action Show, Season 27, Episode 1. My name is Chris.
My name is Matt.
Good morning to you, Matt.
Good morning.
Good to have you back.
Good to be back.
In studio, at least.
Yes.
So we got a big show this week. Should I tell folks what's coming up?
Let's hear it.
All right, this week we're going to help you unleash the power multiple personalities on your Linux box.
Multiple personalities, you say?
That's right, Matt. Linux containers. And we're going to talk about a technology that sits on top of Linux containers called Docker that makes it super easy to utilize this amazing technology that's built into every modern Linux box. It's sitting right there on your box right now, and you're not even using it. And we're going to show it to you. We'll have a little demo in the second half of the show.
Sweet. Yeah.
It is an amazing, impressive technology that is one of the beautiful demonstrations of what Linux is capable of, so you're not going to want to miss that.
Oh, yeah.
And then in the news segment, we're going to talk about that new Mangia release, and of course, CineArch's successor is also been released.
That's big news.
And also, a ton of stuff came out of Ubuntu UDS this week.
Lots of stuff.
So we'll cover some of the highlights of that, as well as a few other very exciting news stories. And then we have some great feedback at the latter half of the show. That people have been thinking big about some of the topics that have been on the show recently, and we're going to circle back to a couple of them and read people's thoughts. So I think it's going to be a fantastic
episode. It's going to be huge. Big show.
All right. Then let's start with our picks this week.
All right.
First up, the runs Linux, Matt, and it was very timely. I had to go with this one. Google Glass runs Linux. Now, Google Glass,
you say.
You know, the new experimental.
Yeah.
Well, Google Glass, by default, runs Android.
I was going to say.
Yeah, but at an I.O., at the Google I.O. conference that was just happening this past week, they were having a breakout session, and the developers of Google Glass were on stage demonstrating how you can root your device and then run Ubuntu inside the operating system of Google Glass.
Interesting.
And one of the developers of Google Glass actually runs Ubuntu full-time on there and develops in Emacs on his Google Glass.
Wow.
Yeah. So they ran Ubuntu 12.04. They took an image and they uploaded it to the Google Glass. And it's a combination of a couple of different apps where it runs inside the app and then you VNC into that app.
Okay.
So,
so that's how you're accessing it is through VNC.
But
okay.
It's very cool. I mean, the concept of, sort of operating system inception on a pair of glasses.
It's pretty hardcore. But when I was reading the article, one of the things I noticed is they said, now don't get too excited because you're not going to be doing commands or stuff. It's not like you're going to be doing this in space or anything. It's,
right.
That would be crazy. Or you have a kernel panic.
Not yet.
I'm just saying, you're not doing none of that. So
Not yet. It's only early days, Matt. It's only early days. You never know. I just love the fact that any new technology that comes out, like, you give it a week.
Right.
And then Linux is on it. Like,
it's just how they roll, right?
Yeah. And it doesn't matter if it's a pair of glasses or what. A supercomputer, Linux is going to be on it. And I just think it beautifully demonstrates, once again, the impressive scalability of the operating system that we all love so much.
Definitely.
So there is an article. There's several articles of it online. A couple of them have been linked in our show notes. If you want to watch it, go to linuxactionshow.reddit.com and find one of the links in there to the YouTube presentation. It's online. It's a little long, but they actually do it in real time. This screenshot that we're showing here is taken from the video presentation. Also, what was really cool is the presenters themselves were doing all the hacking. So they had the Google Glass plugged into a laptop that was running Ubuntu. So the presenters themselves were also running Ubuntu.
I like that.
Yeah.
I like that.
I love seeing that. Of course, now we know that Google has their own sort of offshoot of Ubuntu.
Or something like that. Yeah.
Gubuntu. And so that's what they run there at Google. What I did notice though, and you can kind of see it in the screenshot, is it does say Ubuntu desktop up there. So I don't know if this is the Gubuntu derivative or if it's straight up 12.04.
That's hard to say.
Pretty cool though.
It is very cool. I like the fact that they're trying new things and showing it off.
Okay, so I have two desktop app picks this week. One's my actual app pick, and it's a very cool demonstration. Actually, both the app picks this week are very, very cool demonstrations of up-and-coming technology. Very exciting stuff. And then my Android pick is, I think it's going to surprise some of you.
I was impressed when I was looking at it.
Really?
I was like, hey.
It is neat, right?
It's kind of cool. I was like, I'm going to install that.
All right, but first, before we get to that, I want to thank this week's sponsor, GoDaddy.com. GoDaddy.com, world's number one domain name registrar. Now, GoDaddy is, I don't know if you know this, but they're actually a big contributor to the Apache project. They run thousands of Linux servers. But when you think about it, Matt, GoDaddy has been sponsoring the Linux Action Show longer than both of my children have been alive.
Whoa!
Longer than we get emails. Wow. We get emails from people who have 4 and 5 year old children watching the show with them. GoDaddy's been sponsoring for longer than those kids have been alive that
That's
are watching our
crazy.
Show.
Crazy.
And there is a there's a reason why GoDaddy has been sponsoring this show for so long. They have a vested interest in the Linux ecosystem. And so they believe that by sponsoring this show, they're contributing in some way to the Linux ecosystem by bringing more and more people into Linux, getting people passionate about open source projects that are out there, spreading the word about technology. It's a seed way to get the, you know, to get people out there in open source. And they also want to give you guys great deals so that way you can go out there and create something great. Or a cat website.
I'm just saying, it's like I was telling Chris earlier, right now there's a big buyout boom of anything with the word Bitcoin in it, yeah. and 3D printer or 3D yeah. printing.
Yeah.
Buy now.
Yeah.
I'm telling
it
you.
It really is. You know, it really, I've actually been seeing a lot of threads on that. And so GoDaddy knows you guys like some great deals. So we've got some of the best deals you're going to find
get
for GoDaddy.com. Go over there when you're checking out. Use the code Linux249 and you'll get your .com for $2.49. Mm-hmm. And it's just $9.99 after that. And if it's your first purchase, we're going to get 32% off whatever you want. Use the code Go32Off2, 32% off your entire order. So if you're doing some certs, maybe some hosting, nice. That's the one to use. That's a great savings. And by using those codes, you tell our sponsors that you appreciate them supporting our show. And that's another reason why GoDaddy's been around so long is because you guys have been great in patronizing our sponsors. So we really appreciate that. And we really appreciate GoDaddy.com for sponsoring this week's episode of the Linux Action
Definitely.
Show.
Big thanks.
Yeah, and when you make a site with cat videos, send it to us.
Absolutely. We'll feature your cats.
And don't forget, these are special deals brought to us by the wonderful Danica.
That's right.
I've been hearing about it. I'll tell you next week. I'll tell you next week. All right, Matt. So my Android pick this week might surprise some of you, but let me give you a little background first. A lot of times for my birthday or holidays, people say, hey, Chris, what do you want? And I'll just be like, give me a gift card or whatever.
Sure.
And then I lose them.
That's what I do. Oh, yeah. And see, that's just this. You think you got that stash spot set up, right? And you know, okay, I'm going to totally put it on the fridge. And then you move it, you know, to grab something out. And then you can't figure out what you did with it. It happens all the time.
Right, right.
So frustrating.
So this is where Gift comes in, GYFT for Android, free app. Mm. And I've used it I've used it for about 2 weeks, and I've talked about it on Plan B, our Bitcoin podcast.
Right.
But here's what it does. And I think this is really neat. Is first of all, you can use your camera to scan in your existing gift cards, and like depending on if the gift card supports it, like a Best Buy or Amazon or Newegg, it can actually go out and retrieve the balance.
Oh no!
And
really?
Then on the it lists all your cards here, and then it displays their balance, remaining funds in that gift card. So you can kind of use it as like a little debit card. And here's what's really cool about Gift, and it doesn't spam you a bunch. It does spam in app, but it doesn't give you like spam notifications and stuff
that.
Check out this, Matt.
All right.
I hit Gift here.
You hit.
And I say add a gift card, right? Or actually, I say buy a gift card.
Oh, so you can buy through the app. Ooh.
You can buy and gift gift cards from like 50,000 different retail locations. Now, here's the reason why I like this a lot. You see this Amazon one right here,
yeah.
or any of these actually,
right.
any of these Foot Locker's in here, GameStop,
some Chili's,
the Gap, Chili's, Adidas. I mean the 50,000 retailers are in here, right?
You got a lot.
I hit Amazon. Say I make it a $25 gift card. Right,
yeah. You've got it all selected. You're good to go.
Super easy little interface. I just tap, tap, tap. When I hit this, it says generating order. And then you see that little, you see what it says right there? What's it say with that?
Pay and gifted.
Pay with Bitcoin.
Oh, pay with Bitcoin.
Pay with Bitcoin. So this allows you to take your Bitcoins that some of you may have and then convert them into gift cards for any of these 50,000 retailers. So if you have a little bit of Bitcoin balance because you've been playing around,
you can cash that out into something you can apply.
And Burger King's in here. You know, restaurants are in here. Claim Jumpers is in here. Fisherman's Wharf is in here. So you can convert Bitcoin. So if you're a Bitcoin enthusiast, it's great for that. But if you just want to be able to manage your different gift cards, I know this seems strange, but it's actually very useful. If you want to manage the different gift cards you have and things like that, you just put them in this app.
So
it'll do regular cards or digital ones.
So you have a gift card. You put it on the table. You flip it over. I assume you basically take a picture of the barcode. Mm-hmm. Or
it depends on the card.
But yeah. some identifying mark, and then it uploads the information.
Yeah. So it's GYFT, and it's pretty nice. It's you know, if you have this problem like I do where you lose these things.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, for me, I already got it installed.
And what's cool is you can also, while you're at the retail location, it'll show the barcode of your gift card, and so then you can just have them scan your phone.
Oh,
you don't have to have the actual gift card with you.
That's okay. So that's how that works. Then it's not just for online stuff. You can do this in the real world, and brick and mortar.
Like, you know, you want to Fandango the new Star Trek movie with bitcoins? You can. You know, Fandango's on there. I mean, it's really cool. It's really neat.
Yeah, we have a lot of movie gift cards. You know, like probably
perfect for that. And then you just have them all in the app, and then you just show up at the movie theater and just recall them. You don't have to worry about finding it before you go.
I love that. Or forgetting it.
Yeah.
You get there and you're like, oh man, I forgot the card. That happens a lot too. If it's in your phone, you've got it.
So we've talked a little bit on the show about FreeCiv, which is it's a free and open source empire building strategy game.
Right.
For the Linux desktop, and it's really cool. Well, FreeCiv over at play.freeciv.org is now available in the browser as an HTML5 game. The whole game has been implemented. There's group matching sessions that going on, campaigns, championships that can go on online. It'll do networking. It's the full game implemented in HTML5, and this is just a fantastic technology demo of what's coming down the pipe for HTML gaming. It is the same experience on the desktop, on tablets, or smartphones. Although I don't know, I haven't tried it on a smartphone. Right.
This is what they say. Right.
I just think this is such a great example. This is one of my desktop picks this week. Is sort of the way of the future, Matt. FreeCiv Web can be played online using desktop computer, mobile phone, or tablet. FreeCiv Web has been optimized for the iPhone 5 on mobile and modern HTML5 browsers such as Chrome and Firefox.
Well, and I think what's exciting about this is the fact that it not only is showing what HTML5 can do, but it's also showing, see, you don't necessarily need to develop games in Flash. You can begin looking
right.
at developing.
Very much so.
And that's important. I think we all needed, the community needed a real life
I'm
project
try this.
To point to.
They have this observe function. So here you go. So I'm going into this game and it's logging me in. And I'm observing.
Oh, this
and it
is
tells
sweet.
Them I'm observing. And so here's their freaking game as they're playing. I could just go here and watch these guys play.
Yeah, and it looks like he'd be playing in just a regular game. This is crazy.
Yeah, this is really neat. So, way of the future, HTML5 will rule us all. I believe that's the takeaway from this.
I think really. And I mean, it's, and it can obviously handle a lot of complex stuff. This is really exciting.
I mean, it looks really good. So that's
no Flash.
FreeCiv Web, no Flash required, and I'm pretty damn impressed. All right.
That's awesome.
But something else. I told you we're going to have two kind of proof of technology picks this week.
Yeesh.
This one was linked up a couple of times in our subreddit, and it's called Final Terminal. Don't just use your system. Command it.
Dun, 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 dun.
Final Term is a new breed of terminal emulator. It goes beyond mere emulation and understands what is happening inside the shell and what is hosting it.
Wow.
So they can do contextual menus for commands that come up, smart command completion. Final Term knows when it's displaying a command prompt to you, and it knows all the commands that you have entered. The moment you start typing, suggestions from your terminal history automatically pop up.
Lightning fast
and sorted by an algorithm that ensures what you type is almost always at the top. You also get GUI controls within the terminal. Final Term lets you collapse terminal output, much like a programmer's editor lets you fold code. Final Term recognizes ASCII art scroll bars in the output of supported programs like wget and displays matching GUI scroll bars, allowing you to monitor the progress while output is scrolled away.
That is so cool.
It's definitely here. If you're watching the video version, we got a little demo of it right here. You gotta download the source from Git and build it yourself. It's pretty straightforward to build, though.
There's not a lot of dependency headers.
I didn't see like any repos or anything.
Okay.
And I think there is for the Arch folks. I think it's in one of the Arch repos.
Oh, cool.
And it is not compatible with Vim at this point in time. So that's a little bit of a disclaimer too. But check out, just real brief, like if I do ls, see how it automatically
is so cool. It's making suggestions
and
for you can highlight.
Of course I could tab and stuff, but this is like right there, boom, I hit that and there's my ls-l.
Oh man.
And it's cool the way it sort of updates the screen too. It kind of has sort of
a nice nice bounce to it.
Or watch when I fire off top, it, you know, kind of
that's
another really important point, is it automatically reflows the output of the text in the window. See how it...
Oh, and it's automatically adjusting. So as you expand
gorgeous.
Or condense...
Yes, it's gorgeous. It's something that I really wish the other terminals did, because it's a fantastic feature, Matt. Anyways.
It's really cool.
So see how I have this little arrow right here on the sidebar?
Right, yeah, I noticed that on the side there.
If I click that, it folds, so I can fold sections of what's on my screen away, and then I can come back and then I can expand them later. When you're looking at like directories, you can I'll just show you. So say I'm browsing around here in my home directory, okay?
Okay.
And I do an ls. I can click on GPotter here, and I can say copy name to clipboard. I can say copy. I can do delete here. I can move. I can do a CD to that directory. So if I just click that, it'll automatically CD my command line into that directory.
Oh, that's such a time saver. I mean, it's like, yes, you can type it in yourself or whatever, sure. But it's nice to, if you're in a hurry, you don't have to bother. Just bam.
Well,
bam,
and
bam,
as
bam,
a new
bam,
user, yeah. I might not be familiar with all the right. Linux commands, right?
That's
so
true.
Having kind of hints, like, here I know, and sometimes, like, this, like, clicking on stuff and being able to copy name to clipboard, mm-hmm. that's very nice, you
yes.
know? Or getting to be able to do stat right there on a file, it's very slick. They have some work, you know, on some of the basics still, so this is not really ready for production.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they even put a big disclaimer at the top of their site. They say, to be clear, because some folks have commented on it, yes, this means, unfortunately, essential stuff such as Vim does not yet run inside Final Term. Although development seems to be progressing at kind of a crazy breakneck pace, so I wouldn't be too surprised to see if they don't have that resolved.
Well, have you tried like Pico, Nano, things like that?
Not much. I could I'll try it right now.
It'd be interesting, just to, you know, because I know you mentioned that Vim.
So let's see. What do I have in here that I could? Let's do. We'll do Nano-W. So we'll do a wide, and we'll do my settings.json.
Yeah.
Oh, this is the other thing that's nice,
oh,
too,
wow.
is it does a little code recognition. It'll actually do highlighting in the document, too.
Oh, that's so much... it's nice because you can, like, immediately see
yeah,
without
yeah,
having to, like,
yeah.
squint and kind of...
Yeah, it's a little jumpy. It's not perfect. You see, it's not updating the screen quite
okay.
perfectly when I'm okay. rolling when I'm rolling around in there. So I'd say it's... Yeah, it's now I'm trying to exit, and it's kind of getting all wonky.
I see.
So
okay.
it's still...
Yeah, so probably not so much on Nano.
I mean, it's if you're browsing around, if you're doing some SSH, mm-hmm. doing a little basic system management, I play with a lot. Like I was playing with Docker this weekend,
right?
And I ended up kind of jumping out because I was starting to get some unexpected stuff, and so I just went to the standard straight up terminal. And I was like, oh yeah, that's right, this is a little better.
Now, when you install it, does it override your default terminal?
No.
Okay,
no.
So this is a separate terminal.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So that you could try it, and you're not really messing yeah. with anything. That's cool.
It will be the best terminal emulator for a graphical Linux desktop when it's done.
I think so.
You know?
I mean, it looks very compelling
yeah,
to me.
Yeah. So let's see where. That was Final Term, and we'll have it linked in the show notes, but you can also head over to, well, very simple, finalterm.org.
Easy to find.
And,
easy to remember.
Right there. Yeah.
Cool.
There you go, Matt. Those are our picks this week. So you know what that means.
What does that mean?
Let's do the news.
Hey, it's the news, and this episode is brought to you by...
Ting.com. Matt, Ting.com is mobile that makes sense, and they've been my mobile provider for about 3 or 4 months now. I'm thrilled. I want to tell you guys about them. Look, go to last.ting.com. You get yourself $25 off your service or your first device. Now, here's what I love about Ting is they are hip, Matt. Check this out. So they've got a lot of great Android devices.
They do.
They've already got the Samsung Galaxy S4.
Oh, no
Boom.
Kidding.
And
wow.
you can own it. You buy it and you freaking own it. And they've got the HTC One. Buy it and own it. Man, am I freaking out right now, Matt. I don't know what to do. I think I'm actually now leaning more towards the S4 because I've heard better things about their implementation of Android.
Okay. That's important.
But, you know, maybe you're not in the market to get yourself a brand new one. Ting also offers a lot of great deals on used devices. So you can go in here and check this out. You can get a Galaxy Samsung Nexus S, Samsung Nexus S, $88.
Seriously? That's actually downright reasonable.
Galaxy S2 okay. Epic 4G, $150.
Wow.
These are contract free.
I like that.
Just,
so you own it. There's none of this
you buy it,
subsidized
you go to the website, you set it up, and within 15 minutes... You're there. You've used
like it.
It's awesome. Now, here's what I've used Ting now for a few months, here's what I've really realized about Ting is I was never happy with my old mobile provider because I knew I was being taken advantage of, right? I realized
Oh, they're raking you over the coals, man. It's
those contracts
like, yeah.
are how they make the money.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
I just kind of tucked my tail between my legs and I just took it because I wanted the new gadget. And I was sort of feeding this bad consumerist element of my personality.
True.
And I was like, ah.
I think a lot of us fall into that, right? And so that these guys are actually providing you a way to escape that whole thing.
They put the power back in the consumer's hands because here's what's great. Ting is no contracts or no early termination fees. No bundled ride-along services, no overcharges or penalties. If you use more than you thought you would, you just pay for what you use. Here's the kicker. They also credit you on your unused service. If you use less than you thought you would, Ting drops you down to the next level and hits you with the difference.
Nice.
And this is what the situation when the consumer is in control. This is why I love Ting.com because I put the power back in my old hands. You know, I took my bill. I went over to Ting's savings calculator, which they have linked right here at the top of their website. You plug that in. And you see the difference.
And it's just kind of a wake-up call. It's like, what am I doing?
Right. And when the consumer wow. controls the relationship, then you get things like your data plan includes hotspot and tethering just included. Whatever data plan you get, It's there. There's no like secret extra thing you got to pay for. It's just included. Go check out the Ting plans. Go over to ting.com or last.ting.com so that way you get our discount. Click on the plans, do a little mix and match, and be amazed. Look at Matt. Look at this one here. 500 minutes, right?
Sure.
4,000 text messages and a gigabyte of data a month. Right. $50.
Oh, man.
And that data includes hotspot. And you can turn these things down and mix and match as you like. Just go play with this, you guys, and see what I'm talking about. They also have an incredible online and powerful control panel that I really appreciate, too. So last.ting.com, own your mobile service. And let's be real. Whether we like it or not, mobile is the future. And these guys are getting a lock-in on the future of computing platforms from top to bottom, from owning your device instead of you owning it, from getting you in these locked-in contracts that hold you hostage for 2 years, to nickel and diming you for every single service that these devices just need to essentially function for you. We have got to put a stop to this. Ting is the company that is competitively in the open market making a difference. So let's throw in behind Ting. Go to last.ting.com. Save yourself $25 off your first device. Or if you bring your own device, $25 off your service. And thanks to Ting.com for sponsoring Linux Action Show.
Like it.
All right, Matt. Our first story is so exciting this week. Yeah. Spain's Extremadura. How do you say that? Extremadura.
Whoop.
Oh. Whoop. Warning, Matt.
I turned my ringer off, and I was like, wow. Okay.
That was apparently a pretty severe warning there. I like that. Wow. Maybe they're calling to tell you that they're switching 40,000 PCs to Linux.
40,000?
40,000.
Good grief.
Yeah, these are government PCs. They're going to open source software. They're going to it's going to use a customized Linux distribution called Sysgoblex.
What now?
Look at that word, Matt. Sysgobs.
What we need
is one of our amazing Spanish viewers to help translate for us.
American educational system. What do you want?
And they believe it's going to save them about 30 million euros, which is almost 38 million USD,
good
I think.
Grief.
The previous government had already switched 70,000 PCs. So now this is the new government. They're coming in. The decision to migrate 40,000 PCs to open source software is a lot larger than that migration we've been hearing about in Munich, but it's actually still considerably smaller than the 90,000 machines that the French government switched to open source. And I think it's awesome
to
hear
about.
That is
awesome. That's very cool. Although we're still working on the pronunciation.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Well, if maybe some of these public sectors in the damn U.S. would start doing this, we wouldn't have such a hard time with the pronunciation, but we're not as hip as these other guys. It's just the facts.
This is what it is.
This next story is very exciting. Just broke today on the 19th, Sunday. Wow. And Mangia 3.0 is released. All grown up.
Wow.
The world's nicest Linux community has released their latest Linux distribution. Mangia 3 features RPM 4.11, kernel 3.8, KDE 4.10.2, GNOME 3.6, XFCE 4.10, systemd 195.
Wow.
And LibreOffice 4.03. And they've also packaged Steam for Linux.
Nice.
And
like
you can go check out the new Mangia. I was actually going to try to download a little live. I did download, but the download didn't finish by the time we went on air. So I was going to do a little demo, but
that would have been cool. But, hey, it's there for us.
Congratulations. Now, remember, for those of you who don't quite recall, but Mangia's roots can be traced back to Mandrake and goes way, way back. And this is sort of been reborn. The Phoenix has risen, and the community has released their third
interesting
release.
To see how it turns out for them. Definitely.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. Speaking of interesting to watch how things turn out, CineArch, we reported about a month or so ago.
I think it was about a month.
We're kind of going away because Cinnamon was falling behind in the Arch repos, and they're going to restructure and sort of rebrand and base themselves around multiple desktops. Here's another pronunciation stumble.
Oh, man.
Antergos Linux.
It's called Ant.
Antergos Linux, successor to CineArch, has been released. You can select between GNOME, Cinnamon, XFCE, and the Razer QT desktop. Remember that lightweight QT desktop
like
we called? Ships with GNOME 3.8.1.
Very cool. Very cool.
And that's also the default choice, by the way.
Okay.
It's GNOME 3.8.1. So I did a little. I got a little download of it right here, Matt. So here it is.
Oh yeah.
I got.
Ooh, hey, that's nice.
Yeah, okay. Maybe we'll. Maybe we'll move it over to the other desktop here. Whoop, bop, bop.
There we go.
So you just. If you know yourself a little GNOME 3.8, then you know yourself this. It is straight up vanilla GNOME 3.8, and I did experimenting. They include like the that package management front end to the Arch repos, which is very nice. And through that Pacman XG. Through that, I downloaded and installed Steam.
Slick.
That's right.
I'm loving this so far.
Litmus test,
very
right?
Clean.
Yeah. So here's my Steam library, and I got it loaded up right here under this and Tirjos, or however you say it. It's a very clean GNOME setup, very modern. I mean, it's pulling down, like, it's pulling down, when I installed it, it was pulling down the latest packages of systemd, Linux kernel.
That's
it's
so
very
cool.
Fresh, and it's Arch compatible.
I'm not
a very easy way. You just get rolling in Arch. You just very graphic, nice, and it's got a, I believe it uses Ubuntu's installer. I think I reckon it was reskinned, but I believe it was Ubuntu's installer.
I like the fact that it's not a lot of messing around. I mean, I'm busy. My time is valuable to me. So this allows me to kind of experiment a little bit with some Arch action. Yeah, I check it
totally
out.
Totally does. It totally does. And you could also go the KDE route, which has kind of been your flavor.
Yeah, I might check the KDE out for sure.
And the Razer QT, which is So it's fun. I like it a lot. I played around with it for a few hours this weekend, and I'm pretty impressed. You never know, I might get a wild hair, Matt.
Locking it.
I might end up reload.
Got some good packages.
I might reload. They're off to a great start. Off to a really great start, and that is, a nice implementation of an up-to-date GNOME. I think if you're going to be a GNOME user, trying to stay very current in GNOME behooves you, because they keep adding stuff.
Absolutely.
All right, another distro release. We're just cranking through some distro releases. Feels old school here.
I love this, huh? Yeah.
Linux Mint 15 RC has been released.
Right on.
This one made a lot of headlines.
It had some new features from what I was reading.
I think even Engadget covered this, and it's going to ship them with Mate 1.6 and Cinnamon 1.8, the latest Cinnamon. And it includes tons of new features, like a new login screen that can be themed using HTML5.
Wow.
And this is one you see. Look at that. Look at that beautiful
login
screen.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Yeah. But what do you think of this, Matt? Let's take a look at what I think might be your favorite thing. They've got a new software sources manager here. And look at this little PPA option here to manage your PPAs built in. Additional repositories, authentication keys, right?
About time.
One checkbox for right here, boom, boom. I think this is very nice, friend. And the Mint developers have created this on their own. They've also created a tool that will go out and benchmarks the fastest.
That's cool. Now,
mirrors.
I see Ubuntu used to have, and I think they still do, to where it will do the testing, but it's not showing with the little graphs and the colors and all that.
And that, by the way, that Pac-Man NG that we were just talking about also does that. Here's the other thing. They've revamped the drivers manager that Ubuntu uses. They've broken it out into its own window.
That's an
choice. They've given the descriptions a little bit more room, so it's a little easier to read them. It's not quite as cramped.
Okay.
They're calling it Mint Drivers. It relies on the same Ubuntu backend, but they've put their own polish on top. Cinnamon 1.8 represents 7 months of development. It features a lot of bug fixes, improvements to the Nemo file manager, desklets.
Nice.
I played a lot. So there is, if you Google around for it, there's also PPAs to put the latest Cinnamon on Ubuntu.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I did that. And
how'd that work out for you?
My favorite thing is they've done something that KDE does, where you can right click and say, I want to add a desklet or I want to add a new theme. And then now in the theme picker or in the desklet picker or in the extension, because Cinnamon supports extensions.
Yeah.
It will go out and download from the repository all of the themes or extensions or desklets
in
the panel.
That's one of the features I love in KDE, so that would be cool to try that in Cinnamon.
And it gives you their rating, and then you can check multiples. You just go check, install, and it just downloads and installs them.
And then set them as you wish.
Yep, and then you just go and apply them. It was a really slick feature.
I'm liking that.
I had one didn't install, but
But that happens in KDE, too.
So. They've revamped the control center. I guess they've been putting a lot of attention into the control center. It looks pretty good, I guess.
It's not too bad. It's, nothing to write home about, but it's not bad.
Yeah. They've done some back-end improvements, too. Mm-hmm. Looking really good. I think when this puppy ships, and it's supposed to ship by the end of May, which is coming up. I mean, we've got a couple of weeks. I think we should give this one a review on the
show.
I think
so. Yeah. I think there's enough going on and enough changed to where it is worth a review.
Mongoose in the chat room, or in the subreddit, gave us a quick look. He said, I ran it on a live CD with the Cinnamon desktop, going through boot and play with settings and applets on my HP Pavilion with 8 gigs of RAM. He said, no more than 2% of my four cores. He used about 315 megabytes of RAM, so it's pretty low memory usage. I had LibreOffice and GIMP running during this time. RAM never went above 430 megabytes of usage.
Really?
The only thing I didn't like was at first how the settings collapsed from normal to advanced, and the display was advanced, and it took a little digging to get to it. Yeah, this is a thing now. When you go in there, all of the settings are set to simple mode, and there's a little button at the bottom that turns them into advanced mode.
That's not too bad, as long as you don't have to dig too much.
Yeah, once you get the hang of it, it's smooth sailing. Mm-hmm. So he gave his opinions. There's other people that kind of threw in here. So it's looking like a good first release, and he updated to 24 hours after the install. So far, so good. Tons of polish and easier-to-use interfaces all over. He said, in Ubuntu 13.04, I could connect my Nexus 7, and it mounted no problem, and was able to move stuff around. Mm. He says that it hasn't been the case on Mint yet, but they're working on that.
Okay, that's getting there.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, so thanks, Mongoose, for giving us the sort of on-the-ground report. And, as it as it lands, we'll do additional coverage.
Like it.
One last Mint story before we move on. Of course, Linux Mint is completely community contributed, and I really respect that. And some other search partnerships and things like that. This is cool. Speaking of Bitcoin earlier, Linux Mint project now accepting Bitcoin donations.
Nice. I like that. Good
as
for them.
Is the GIMP project, and it makes sense. An open source currency probably fits well with open source projects, and people are donating from all around the world from countries that don't have PayPal.
Brings in revenue for the project as well. That's important.
All right, I want to talk about something. Speaking of bringing in revenue for projects, Ubuntu UDS was this week, and we got a lot of details on up and coming changes. So this was their second virtual UDS package, and one among the many things they covered was click packages, switching from Firefox to Chromium as the default web browser, possibly having a technology demo of Unity 8 with Mir in Ubuntu 13.10 as an optional login environment for testing. I think that's pretty aggressive, but then they also want to focus on Unity 7. And the terms and phrase quality and polish brought work came up about 1,000 times during the UDS.
That's good. They always use more polish.
You really can't complain. No. Unity 8 is going to be very much a technology preview, so people need to kind of brace themselves for that.
Yes.
They're also talking about down the road doing things like applications will be started via Upstart.
Okay.
And a lot of other really big tweaks.
And that's going to be some. There's going to be some bumps in the road with that. I think I really do.
Yeah, the news about Chromium replacing Firefox as the default web browser created quite a bit of consternation. Canonical also shut down Brainstorm, the sort of dig-like site where you could go and submit ideas.
And I'm not surprised. That was such a fail to begin with. It was a nice idea, but it just it was why have the the forums Brainstorm? I mean, just all these. It just kind of became a mess. Yeah.
I've included a link in the show notes that is one of the things the Ubuntu team did is they did a wrap-up video where they kind of covered the different tracks that everybody had and what was covered in that area. So you can watch this one wrap-up video and then figure out if there's videos you want to go see on yourself. So the main topics were the Ubuntu SDK, the core apps that need to be tweaked, Unity 8, Ubuntu Server, Community Roundtables, Desktop Polish were all really big topics.
And maybe even throw in a calendar just for giggles. Just saying.
We're watching, and I think people are starting to pick up on this. Zaytech in the chat room said, is Ubuntu becoming the next Mac? He says, I was trying to explain the whole not Windows realm of computing and trying to say we're OS X. I realized that this is really the direction Ubuntu is going for Linux. The simple breakdown is Ubuntu is to Linux is what OS X is to BSD.
No, and the reason why is because of what it can be installed on. You're not with OS X to be legal, you're installing it on approved hardware, period. With Ubuntu, you can install it on a soda can if you can figure out a way to do it. You can
install Glass.
Yeah, you can install it in on a potato if it's got chips in it. I mean, they don't care, so you don't have those restrictions. So that's the biggest differentiator.
Let me put this to you. So I would say they are in some ways potentially inspired by OS X, and I think the reason for this is as a market you look at so HP this week just announced a new touchscreen hybrid tablet laptop,
right?
And this laptop is shipping with Ubuntu.
Okay,
it's shipping with Ubuntu 12.04.
Right. Okay.
And I think the two reasons they chose Ubuntu and 12.04 is as an outside, and I think this is maybe hard for our audience to grok, but as an outside observer to the Linux system, it looks like this wild, wild west of always changing technologies. Mm-hmm. And as somebody who needs to sort of bet the farm on a product and base that product on a technology when it's moving around a lot, that's a very risky proposition. And
so going with the long-term release makes sense in that space.
Right, and going with Ubuntu makes sense because when you look at Ubuntu, you can kind of see, okay, I see a pattern here, I see a company here, and I'll give you an example, and I'm probably going to get flamed for this. Systemd. Man, don't we love Systemd. Man, that is some sweet-ass technology that Red Hat is working on a bunch of other people, and it is cool, right?
It's very cool.
But as an outsider, I look at Ubuntu and I go, you know, they've used that same init daemon for a very long time now. That's stability. And I look over at this other distribution. They're changing init systems. They're changing file systems. That's very unpredictable.
There's a lot of activity.
That's very scary.
And so I think, and they may also be looking at historically when they've sold Linux computers in the past, just various vendors. There's always been that kind of hit and miss with a target audience. So if you're trying to introduce this to a new audience, you want to make this as seamless and as hassle-free as possible because they're not targeting you guys. They're targeting just the average folks. And so, yeah, I think that matters.
So there's here's some of the base logic that Canonical uses for building a platform that sort of takes the best of breed technology and sort of congeals it into something that people can be comfortable with that are outside the mm-hmm. Linux system that can appeal to the masses. Here's the problem I see with that. Is if they're successful at this, there, you know, with Mir and Upstart and all this stuff, there is the potential possibility that they will create applications when you're writing for Ubuntu mm-hmm. that are completely incompatible for other Linux distributions.
Okay. Right.
And maybe for mass users, that's not a problem. They won't even know it's an issue.
Sure.
But what it does is overall, it'll erode the usage of the other distributions. The thing is Canonical's entire software stack is built on top of the shoulders of other giants. And if you begin to erode the foundation of those other giants, you're essentially poisoning your own well of future code.
I don't know about that. I think that there's... It's kind of like, you know, looking at a lot of the newcomer smartphone platforms as well as the compared to the existing ones and things like that. I think that everything's going to kind of settle in its own space. Will this affect other? Let's say, how does this affect Debian? How does this affect which of course Ubuntu is based on, that sort of thing. I don't see it being any more effect down the road than I do see it now. I don't think there's going to be any real hassle there. I think there's enough of a differential and enough of everybody's kind of got their feel for where they're going. I don't see it as an issue.
Let's just get crazy. This can never be a problem. This is a huge exaggeration, but let's just put it out there. So the Ubuntu developers are talking about using Chromium as the new default web browser. And mm-hmm. one of the reasons for this is because the mobile version uses WebKit.
Right.
And because the mobile version uses WebKit, Canonical now considers himself invested in the future success of Blink or WebKit or whatever. So they want to, and they also want a consistent experience. Right. So if a browser page renders in one way on mobile, they want it to render the same on the desktop. Mm-hmm. What if they start making a series of decisions that are sort of secondarily beneficial to the desktop, but primarily beneficial to mobile, that kind of hurt desktop a little bit, make it a little less perfect to use, a little less ideal to use? And they just keep making hundreds of these. So you have, you know, the 1,000-cut scenario, where overall they keep making compromises in favor of mobile, and by doing so, after time, they erode the usability of the desktop.
Oh, I can absolutely see that happening. But here's the beautiful thing is that you'll have the two audiences, the hardcore users such as us and those people that are new to Linux. Both parties will, in fact, move on. Now, the newer users may end up going back to other proprietary operating systems, or maybe they'll just jump over to Mint. Who knows? As far as the hardcore users, so many people are jumping over to Arch and other things as it is now. We're already distro hoppers, so it's really not such a big deal. If it fails, great. If it succeeds, awesome. I don't see it having a long-term effect because as diverse as Linux is, I don't see it having a long-term effect on the ecosystem in any way, shape, or form other than its own demise, for Ubuntu's own demise.
We had a few comments in the subreddit, and I wanted to kind of highlight a couple of these because they stirred my thinking, Matt. He said, so here's one from Mage. He says, while I wouldn't say there's an equal comparison yet between Ubuntu and OS X, it's headed in that direction. OS X took much of BSD's underpinnings, changed some systems, altered some things, and added a new GUI and other features. The combination of these actions made Apple less and less compatible from where it was originally derived. Ubuntu is heading in the same direction. Yeah. They've altered some of the underpinnings specifically for Ubuntu, creating a new GUI, etc. While Ubuntu is not nearly at the same level of incompatibility as OS X, it definitely seems to be heading in that direction.
Yeah, I mean, and it absolutely is it becoming an OS X? You betcha, you betcha it is. And if that is that bad or good for those that use it, I guess it's good. For those that don't use it, who cares? I don't see it as a negative in any way, shape, or form. How does OS X affect me in my life? Let's say I was a hardcore BSD guy, and OS X is just completely taken and borrowed and whatever. It doesn't affect me.
Well, okay.
How does it affect Alan?
What if Apple had chosen Linux?
Okay.
And they made it so if you want to write an app for OS X Linux, it only runs on OS X Linux.
Sure.
Then as a Linux user, mm-hmm. you could be screwed because all these companies are writing applications for OS X Linux, like Adobe and Microsoft and everybody. They're not writing it for OpenSUSE.
True. But at the end of the day, it is what it is. If those companies choose to do that, we will have to adjust. And we've been adjusting for years.
That's true. And like Cispress points out, like you were saying, as long as they don't lock it down to overpriced hardware, as long as you can load it on any device you want,
it's not the same
thing.
And even if they did something like that, even if they did lock it down to hardware, which is a horrible thing, and I'm sure they'll never do it, but even if they did, vote with your dollars. Vote with your time. Don't be one of these picketing type folks. Just walk away from it and be like, you know what? Not for me. I'm going to this distro.
But here's a concept I want to bust. And not because I have any particular, I want to throw in behind any company or any distribution.
Sure.
But George Zilla in the subreddit says, Shuttleworth is a Jobs wannabe. Ubuntu is an OS X wannabe. Rabbit Ubuntu fans, like many here, are Apple fanboy wannabes. Canonical is an Apple wannabe. And, you know, we have sort of poked fun at that concept with Shuttleworth and being kind of a Jobs wannabe. Yeah. And I would say this is sort of like what I think that is, that attitude, because you see it a lot. You see it a lot online.
Yeah, people, yeah,
is this how people who aren't critically thinking about the facts justify their decisions to themselves internally by making everybody who likes something a fanboy, and by making the company a wannabe or a knockoff, you are justifying to yourself why you shouldn't take them seriously. So when you see people posting, what they're really saying is, I'm delusional and I'm tricking myself and I'm trying to convince all of you because I also want you to believe, because if I can convince you, that only reaffirms my own belief. And that's what that post actually is, because let's be honest. Right. You know, Mark Shuttleworth is not a Steve Jobs knockoff.
No.
What Mark Shuttleworth is somebody who has taste, just like Steve Jobs had taste. Very good taste. Mark Shuttleworth has entrepreneurial business sense, just like Steve Jobs did. And those kind of components, when combined in the right position, can make a fantastic leader. And you know, I have talked to Mark on several occasions in person and over Skype, and I can tell you Mark is a combination of somebody who can be incredibly humble and somebody who can also have a very large ego about certain things, but he is no Steve Jobs. And I think when people make those kind of claims, they're just kind of being silly. What Canonical is doing is nothing like what Apple does. They are still producing open source code. Yes, there's the Canonical agreement that sucks balls and I wish they would drop it, but it is still a quantum leap difference than what Apple does, right?
Well, I'll even take it to shorter. People that spend that much time concerning themselves with a distribution or a product that they don't like confuse me. Why? It's like I don't like Dr. Pepper, for example. Just an example. It's not a soda that I like.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah. And why would I spend all my time ranting and complaining and snarling and snarling about it when I can be like, I don't like it, and I move on. I don't. So for me, it's a bigger picture. Is he one thing or another? This is a man who has figured out, however you want to measure it out, this is how we get something to market, and this is how we make that successful.
Yeah. And I would argue.
Does that make it bad or good? It makes it sellable.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, not for me, but hey, well, more power to him.
You know, I mean, is you know? Shuttleworth up there? You know, kind of doing a keynote that kind of reminds us of Steve Jobs.
Yeah.
Yes, so is every other freaking technology company on the planet giving Apple-like keynotes now, trying to wow us.
Sure.
And you know what? Have you looked at Apple sales numbers recently, people? Despite what you might hear in the headlines about their stock, they're selling an S-ton of computers now.
They're doing really
Apple
well.
Is selling a crap ton of laptops. Maybe there's a reason for that. Mm-hmm. Maybe they figured out something. So if Canonical gets a few inspirations from a company who has been demonstrously successful, and they're helping deploy Linux by doing that, why are we criticizing that? You don't have to agree with everything they're doing.
That's true. Well, I take a very agnostic point of view, because I honestly, they fail, they succeed, I don't care. But I agnostically, I would say, you know, just looking at it logically, the end of the day, if you want to be successful, it's not rocket surgery. I know you guys love that. It's not rocket surgery. Emulate someone who you wish to be like. Well, in this particular case, I would suggest they are definitely emulating a lot of aspects of Apple.
I don't know if it's Apple, you know, as a
certain way they do things.
Maybe not Apple as, you know, because I mean Canonical isn't getting into the litigation stuff. Canonical isn't locking devices down using, you know, hardware encryption keys. Canonical,
so those are the things they aren't emulating. But I'm saying there's aspects of their marketing, there's aspects of the way they experience.
I just think it's ridiculous fanboy hyperbole that people get so worked up about this and pretend like they're anything like Apple, when all of the code they're creating for the most part is open source code.
Yeah.
It is bound by the CDL, and I agree that sucks, but it just strikes me as people getting a little bit caught up and a little bit lost and maybe getting just slightly out of touch with reality on this issue.
It's obviously this is where they choose to invest their time. Personally, I prefer to have a life and actually experience other things that are more positive. It's an example. You hate Ubuntu, so you can spend all your time ranting and raving and complaining about it, or you can take a positive spin and find a distro that's really meeting your needs. Let's say you're into Arch. Get on the positive train with that. Quit spending all your time boo-hooing about something you don't like.
And like Ground Zeroes in the chat room. Now we're getting all worked up defending it. I don't intend to defend. I'm just trying to bring rationality to the
conversation. I use OpenSUSE. I don't give a rip. I'm just looking at this from a black and white point of view. Don't like it? Don't use it.
Yeah.
But for someone to get what I, so for me, I get worked up over futility. I see negative actions as futile. People whining and crying because they don't like something. Either if you feel that strongly about it, don't use it. So I'm offering a suggestion. I don't care.
Let's see what happens. You know, if they can pull it off, let's see what they do. If they can't pull it off, then you guys all get to sit back and laugh.
Yeah.
And this is the risk they take. All right.
Cool.
I want to talk about a little bit of hardware before we get out of the news, just because we're going to be doing some Raspberry Pi stuff coming up soon on the show. So we thought we'd give a shout out to the Raspberry Pi project. They've just announced that the camera module is now available. It's been in development for a little while, but the module can be purchased from RS Components or Element 14, and is based on a 5 megapixel sensor, and it also supports 1080p video at 30 frames per second.
Nice.
Software.
Very cool.
Yeah, and it's just a little module you plug in.
Yeah, pop that sucker in there.
Software, which would probably make it great for like a little security camera system.
I was going to say, I could see some potentials.
Especially when you can do 1080p video. Software support is already included in the Raspbian distribution, which is Debian for Pi.
Mm-hmm.
Users need to update the latest version and then run the Raspi config and select camera to enable support.
Like it.
Yeah, dude. Raspberry Pi. We're going to be playing with that very soon on the show, so I just love it. They must already be working on the new.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Of course.
We're going to be hearing details about that soon. All right, Matt. Well, that's all the news for this week. It's time to tell you about one of the coolest things your Linux box can do that you might not even have known about. And before we jump into that, I want to thank this segment's sponsor, System76, creators of many fine machines born to run Ubuntu Linux, like my Bonobo Extreme.
Love that machine.
We got an email, Matt, I just love this, from Jeff. He says, got my Bonobo Extreme and loving it. Listen to this. Nice. He got his with the gloss screen, which I might have gone with too if it wasn't for the lights in the studio.
Mm-hmm. Right.
32 gigabytes of RAM.
Whoa.
The GTX 680M with a 512 gigabyte SSD and a 1 terabyte hard drive in there separately. He's running Arch Linux with E17 on it. He says it's by far the fastest computer I've ever had. Oh, he included a picture too. Let's go look at the picture. Let's go look. Oh, look at the Bonobos. He's got Conky on there too, or something. He's already got stickers on there. Look at this guy.
He's already decking it out. Nice.
Well, look at that dual monitor setup he's got going too. Okay, that's nice.
I like that idea.
It's like in the closet there. Oh, and he's got a little control pad hooked up to it. Jeff, you crazy.
That's crazy. I love it.
He says there are some things he doesn't like about it. He's not a huge fan of the keyboard, which I actually like quite a bit because it also has the number pad.
Right, right. And he may have been looking for more of a standard laptop keyboard.
He complains about the click pad. You know, there's a lot of people who just do not like themselves a click pad. He says it is one of the nicer ones that he's used, but he's just not,
a click pad guy.
And I agree. I'm not a big click pad either. I have a mouse here, but what I like about the click pad is it supports two-finger, like, see, I can scroll using the two-finger gestures and stuff like that.
It's fully enabled.
I really like that, yeah, and I can zoom using that. I mean, I think that's some nice stuff there. He says System 76 went above and beyond when it came to support. Allowing him to send it back so that way he could buy the glossy screen instead of the matte. So he got the matte first and then sent it back and got glossy.
Wow.
He says, thanks for showing me, thanks for the awesome show and showing me System 76.
That's great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff, for grabbing one and telling the Linux Action Show sent you. We appreciate that. So Linux containers, if you're not familiar with what a Linux container is, I'll give you an overview and then I'll give you some resources to deep dive. Often referred to as LXC, it is it's a set of user space packages that connect with kernel specific enablements that allow sort of like a cheroot on steroids. And what I mean by that is you can create a completely isolated process environment where you can run processes that are isolated from the rest of your system by the kernel. And so, for example, Alan does this using BSD jails.
Right. Now, familiar engine. With that. Okay.
And every customer that Alan has their own jail. And so Jupiter Broadcasting has their own instance of Nginx, our own instance of MySQL, our own instance of Memcache.
It's all compartmentalized.
Right, in its own. Gotcha. The Linux vernacular would be container, but the BSD vernacular is jail. Or Solaris, the vernacular is zones. Mm-hmm. OpenVZ, available for Linux, also provides similar functionality.
And if I'm understanding correctly, it's essentially the same concept. It's just worded differently. Okay.
And I would say, now made much better, thanks to Docker, and much more standardized. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Mm-hmm. Now, Linux containers are completely different than virtualization because instead of emulating the hardware and loading up a whole new kernel and a whole new operating system, mm-hmm. it is just a process on your system like any other process. It just happens to be completely isolated from the rest of the system.
Right.
That process is completely unaware that it's on a computer with hundreds of other processes, which means if a bad guy gets in there and attacks that thing and compromises, say, your Apache server, he doesn't have access to anything else because it's isolated. Or if you're testing something and you want to test on specific versions of software, you can do it in this isolated environment. Or if you need to run multiple versions of software, again.
Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah. So we have the episode we just did, just recently, episode 110 of TechSnap. It goes into this even further. It's jails versus VMs. And kind of we had an email that came in and asked, hey, guys, hey, Alan, hey, Chris, what's the difference between a jail? What's the difference between a VM? We answered that in 110. So if you're still a little fuzzy on it, do a little extra homework and go watch episode 110 of TechSnap. I'll have it linked in the show notes.
That'll catch everybody up.
Yeah.
Nice.
Now, here's been the big hurdle to Linux containers. A lot of big iron shops use Linux containers to implement some sort of hosting service.
Okay.
One such that's pretty famous is .cloud. And .cloud is what's called a platform as a service. So as a developer, you can go there and you can sign up, you can deploy your application on there, and they will host it and scale it. So if you get popular, all of a sudden they'll scale up and they'll scale down, you know, like Heroku, like Google Apps. And it's not, you know, it's not a full system. It's just it's a deployment area. And .cloud uses Linux containers to pull this off. Well, .cloud saw the way the wind was blowing and saw that a lot of shops were getting behind the Linux containers game to power their services and thought, you know what we need to do? Since we're not the only guys in town with containers anymore, we need to make an abstraction layer that sits on top of containers that makes using Linux containers attainable for everybody.
Okay, a way of differentiating themselves and adding value to the customers.
Well, and containers can be a very challenging thing to set up.
Okay.
And so they completely revolutionize how you work with containers. It is incredible. It's called Docker. You can go to docker.io to find out more. Here's their description. Docker is an open source engine which automates the deployment of applications as a highly portable, self-sufficient container which are independent of hardware, language, framework, packaging, system, and hosting provider. That's a super, super fancy way to say they have created a really cool system to deploy and snapshot containers. And they've kind of combined it with a little bit of Git and a little bit of magic.
Okay.
And what Docker will let you do, if you're looking at my system here, I have a list of Docker images on my computer. I have several Ubuntu.
So each line is an image. Okay.
See, I've got an Ubuntu 12.04 here. I've got Ubuntu 12.10 here. Down here, I have CentOS 6.4.
And then each one has an ID number and when it was created. Okay.
These are images. Okay. And I can run things inside these images. And every time I fire off a Docker command, it will take an image, spin up a Linux container, copy the contents of this image into a virtual file system, dynamically assign a NAT, an IP address, to that container, run the application until it completes, and then close the container down and shut it off.
Oh, that's nice. So it does all that for you.
And then I can take these I can take these Docker images and I can snapshot them. So I could say, add all the software packages I need, configure all the services I need, snapshot it, and then every time I run a command, it comes from that original source snapshot, so it's an always known good state. I can deploy out these Docker images through a Git-like service where you can push and pull.
Okay.
So I can create an image, I can push it up to the repository, then you at home could pull down my Docker image
and
run.
Oh, that's very handy.
Yeah.
That's a really nice collaborative option.
And so for developers, it's a great way to sort of say, here's something I've created. I want you to run it, and I'm giving you this Docker image so that way I have a completely predictable environment for you to run it in. It also could be used to isolate applications from each other. So somebody who's creating a mobile Linux platform could use these as individual application sandboxes.
Now, and again, this is as a layman, but basically, does this also offer some security benefits?
Oh, big time.
I would assume so if they're completely isolated.
Totally isolated.
Okay.
And it also allows for controlling of changes. So, you know, I can update my system to the latest version of all the crap, but that container is still 12.04, CentOS 6.4, whatever it is. So I always know it's going to run exactly as I expect it to.
Ah.
So I thought maybe we'd play around a little bit with this. Now, I've only been playing with Docker for a few days, so I'm a little rough. So I'll stumble around a little bit because it's a pretty complex system, but it's wrapped in a lot of easy-to-use commands. So I bring up my Docker. Well, that's not my Docker notes. I bring up my my Docker notes
Locker
here for
notes?
Us. I noted down some of my favorite commands, and I'll try to post these in the show notes. I've got it, Matt. I got like epic amounts of stuff in the show notes this week. It's crazy. So
good stuff.
Oh, it's lots of resources, lots of explanations. But Here, I'll show you. Here, I'll give you a basic. I'll give you a basic little demo here.
Okay.
And the thing is, as I'm showing you this, think about this type of process isolation allows, like Matt was saying, for very high level of security. But the reproducible runtime environment for applications and servers is huge. The fact that you can commit and publish is huge. And what I love is their Git-like system. When you pull a container down, it'll only pull the differences that you need to make that container. It won't pull down like this whole image if it doesn't need to.
So it's efficient.
Very efficient. Very much so. So here I am on Ubuntu 13.04.
Okay.
Right? And I'm going to take this Docker command, and in our slash Etsy segment, we'll walk you guys how to set up Docker on your computer.
Oh, nice.
So that'll be coming up next. But let's say once you've got Docker installed, I just take, now I'm going to paste it here since I already wrote it out before, but I'm saying Docker run interactively the container CentOS and run the command bin bash.
Okay.
Okay, and I'm on Ubuntu 13.04. When I run that, I am now in bash inside a CentOS environment. That's the CentOS file system.
Oh, that's
cool. If I go into slash Etsy and I cat Red Hat release, you'll see I'm on CentOS release 6.4.
Oh, that is so cool. So basically you've kind of like tunneled in, or, you know.
Yeah, I've created Chroot. It's gone and captured the output of that Chroot, and it is redirecting it into my terminal screen. Also dynamically, it's using, I think it's called AUFS. It's created a copy on write file system on the fly for me. It's natted the sucker. So if I do an ifconfig, like I've got a 172.16.42.5 address.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So the Docker project has a bunch of great example commands too. So let's see if we go over here to on their Let's Get Started section. They have all of the stuff you need, which we'll cover in a little bit. Mm-hmm. But if you dig around, they'll give you some. You can deploy on Windows and Mac OS too, but what they do for that is they actually use a little virtualization.
Ah, okay.
Here's some examples. So they have some really awesome examples of like setting up SSH in there, doing hello worlds. I guess there's all kinds of really neat things you could do. One of the things that I did that was really fun is I deployed Gentoo inside a Docker command, and it's full-fledged Gentoo, and it's really awesome. So I also did, and we'll try giving this one a go, is there is a... there is a way to run a GUI application from inside a Docker environment. Now, the reason why this is a good idea...
Is it like almost kind of an X-forwarding type feeling
situation? Yeah, you bind a VNC server to an X... So here's an example.
Okay.
And this is all native. It's all native performance.
So
it's all native speed. So I've already downloaded. I've already checked out the image to run Firefox and VNC. So now with this run command, I'm going to say Docker run on port 5900, this Firefox... Docker instance.
Interesting.
And I'm going to use the password of like 1234. So now on port, so now if I go here and I go VNC, let's see, which this is, you know, live demo, so it may not work.
Yeah.
But we'll do localhost. And it didn't tell me what port it bound it to, actually.
5900.
There's another, that's added port.
Oh, yeah.
Let me see if I don't know if I see it, actually. Initialize. There's supposed to be a NATed port that it goes to. There is a way to look it up. So what that does is it's kind of an amazing command is in the background, it goes out and it pulls down a BusyBox image.
Right.
It downloads Firefox.
So it actually downloads it, installs it, and
checks it out, pulls down the latest version, starts up the network interface, binds 5900 to a network, to a NATed address. And I don't know what it is. I could do a netcat and figure it out, but then I can do a local connection to that and I can... connect into my Firefox instance.
Nice.
It's very cool. And then I can make all the changes I need, save it, and then I can deploy that image out.
Oh man. And it's so awesome.
It's really portable. It's this really neat way for developers to play with a very manageable system where they know exactly what they're going to get. But it's also a great way for server admins to rapidly deploy Apache servers and MySQL servers without all of the overhead of virtualization. So
I
it's going
like
to be
that.
Huge. And it's already huge. But
so your benefits are immediately. You're not having to go full on virtualization, basically running extra resources you shouldn't be having to run with in the first place.
So you get more machine for the... You get way more machine. I wish I could figure out what port it bound to us. I'm not savvy enough with Docker to be able to... There is a command in Docker. So when you run the Docker command, you get like this whole list of stuff. And I can
Docker port, look a public-facing port.
Yeah, there is like a Docker... Yeah, exactly. Docker port, look up. Oh, yeah, that's it, Matt. You got it.
Yeah.
Docker port, and then I think I give it the container.
That's your
password. Is what I do. And then it'll tell me what ports it is using. So you go Docker port... Okay, that's what I do. So I say Docker, and then I say the port, which is 5900. That's the port that it's running on. Inside the Docker container,
right?
Okay. And then I have to give it the there's lots of Docker commands like Docker PS shows me. Wait, what is it? Docker list. There's a Docker command that'll show you all of your running Docker. Docker PS, that's what it was. Yep. Yeah, okay.
Okay, cool.
So here's my different, I have one that I created 15 hours ago that's still running. That's what screwed me up. I already have one running.
Oh, okay.
So here it lists the ports that I'm using, right?
There's your port.
So there's my port that Docker has NATed to the VNC server. So I go over to my VNC server, and I put in my port number, which is crazy, right?
Yeah.
And then I think my password is just 1234. Don't tell anybody, okay?
Yeah, no, okay. That sounds like one I use.
Yeah. And then connect. And it if it works, it might take a little bit. I don't know. But if it works, it'll pull up. There it goes.
Yeah, oh, my goodness.
So that's Firefox running inside a CentOS BusyBox type, I think. It's like a very bare bone. No, it's, you know, it's an Ubuntu image that only contains Firefox and VNC.
And it looks like the way Firefox is rendering, it looks like an X-forwarding.
Totes. There's no Windows decorations. Yeah. It's very rough because it's the absolute bare minimums. But this This is an instance of Firefox 11, 11.0, very old, right?
Yeah.
Running inside a completely isolated environment, and I can click right here. Here's my absolutely latest and greatest Firefox that I have running right here, completely separate on my system, brand new version. So I have these two different versions that are running completely unaware that each other are on the same computer. And it could be any GUI app. I just picked Firefox because that was
it's something. Yeah, totally something you can load up really.
But you see, there's no window decorators, and if I close Firefox here, all you have then after this is like the good old classic X Windows terminal. See, it's right there in the background.
That is so awesome.
Yeah, it's native speeds. The only reason any delay you get is the delay VNC creates.
That's so awesome.
Yeah. And
I like that. That's
Docker, neat. You know, I could have this running Samba servers. I could have this running anything. It's very, very neat. Obviously, I'm just touching the surface. The whole snapshot deploy and retrieve functionality is so cool. There's a Docker search function where you can search for images. So, like, I searched for VNC, right? And it came back with, there's the VNC image. And then I can just do Docker pull, and then I just give it that image name. It goes out to the repo, pulls down that image, and then I can just launch it.
I could see a cheat sheet being really handy here. You know, like just print something up and then just have it next to you.
They've got some guides. They've got some example guides online, and there's also a good community developing on Stack Overflow. This is brand new. It's not quite ready for production, but it's so getting there. And the Dot Cloud guys are whatever. They're switching their infrastructure over to using Docker as well.
Okay.
So they're sort of
maybe it's
worth
putting on a testing server and actually just kind of getting used to it, learning the commands.
And so it's so cool that Linux has this built-in process isolation system
that's awesome.
That honestly, you know, the other guys have had.
They have.
But this Docker implementation on top of it is like, it's like an API for Linux containers.
Well, it does all the heavy lifting for you.
Yes. Yeah.
It totally does.
It's amazing how quick it does it all. And he's just like, you do Docker, blah, blah, blah. And then it does all of this stuff in the background to set it all up. And
it's so awesome. I really like that. It's like, I can see myself playing with this because it's very approachable.
Yeah. And you don't have to worry about breaking anything in there because all of those Docker instances are based on known good images. Mm. So every time they launch, they come from a known good state and then you just snapshot as you need.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So I love that. So yeah, there's no breakage. There's easy to do, you know, print out a cheat sheet, get busy.
Yeah, go
get it on a server.
Go check out the show notes, you guys, because I put a ton of links in there. Like there was a talk that one of the developers gave at PyCon. It's about 5 minutes long. It was like one of those rapid sessions. So I linked to that. I linked a conversation thread we have going in the Linux Action Show subreddit. I asked folks to kind of throw in with their experiences with Linux containers. And there's definitely some good ones. In here, like here's some LXC fundamentals. Containers require any OS installed in the container to run the same kernel. By the way, that is a great point. So over here, I got into CentOS over here at some point, right?
Yeah, you did.
Let's go find my CentOS. So we'll check this out because I think this is kind of cool. So I'll go into Bash again on CentOS, right? Okay. And now I'm in Bash, right? Here I am. But look what I do a uname-a.
Oh, wow.
Ubuntu kernel. So
that's interesting.
Remember, it's not virtualizing.
Right.
It is CentOS now running with its applications off the Ubuntu kernel.
Oh, that's crazy.
Because it's just using a built-in component of the kernel. So like when I downloaded Gentoo, I'm using all of the Gentoo user space system, all of the Gentoo configs, everything Gentoo except for the kernel is still my host kernel, version 3.8.0 in this case. And so that's a good point to mention. It's kind of an interesting element of it, and it shows you really how amazingly compatible Linux applications
are. I like the list of benefits that it provides. I love the speed. I love the fact you're not having, you know, the security and all the extra you know, the benefits it gives with you as far as, you know, making sure that you're able to do this in a reasonably easy fashion. I mean, it's not really that hard. It's just once you have the commands in front of you, it's pretty much just
here's something else that that Linux containers have over virtualization is Linux containers work on ARM, virtualization like Xen and KVM require processor level implementations, so they're not available on ARM. So this is a way to do completely safe containing on ARM systems without requiring virtualization. And ARM's actually making obviously a lot of headway on mobile, but huge headway in server now too. Bulman in the subreddit says, I've been using Linux containers for nearly 2 years on Ubuntu. After discovering what Linux containers could do, it was a real eye-opener for me after using hardware virtualization like VMware, KVM, and VirtualBox for so long. Lately, I've been doing quite a bit of nested LXC containers related to some projects for work. You can create an application container and system containers. Application containers are just for running a single app, as you'd expect.
That's so awesome.
Right? And system containers are built with a complete OS installed in the environment. He said, several weeks ago, I also discovered Linux Containers web portal, which is Ubuntu-specific at this point.
Okay.
I think there's a lot of stuff that's going to be happening here. People are going to be able to build their own Heroku competitors with this.
That's crazy. Well, and what's going to be interesting is, I think this is the real takeaway. Start learning this now. Start becoming more comfortable and familiar with it. Yeah. That way, as it develops and becomes more popular, you're ahead of the game. Yeah. You're not playing catch-up.
I agree with you, Matt. I agree with you. So go check out docker.io for the site. And Docker sits on top of Linux containers. Think of it as a high-level API, which operates at the process level. It runs Unix processes with strong guarantees of isolation and repeatability across desktops and servers.
So cool.
Yeah, I really like it. So that, Matt, is Docker and is the future of Linux cloud hosting. Go check it out. Now in the /Etsy segment, we'll actually show you how to set up Docker on your computer. It might be easier than you expect, with a few caveats. Okay. But before we get to that, I want to thank our segment sponsor, Untangle. Go over to untangle.com and check out what they're offering. Untangle firewalls are awesome. They combine the power of Linux and the ease of use of their special dashboard that make it possible for novices or pros to rock their network with Linux protection. Now, you can get Untangle as an ISO just to try it out yourself and load it on any machine you want. Just go over there and download their free ISO image. They've also got appliances, which is great, so you can have a combination of your own hardware and appliances in different areas. I love this. So what I've done for my clients, for example, is at their main office, I've got an actual full-on 2U rack server running Untangle, right?
Love that.
And then out at the remote locations, we have Untangle appliances.
Ooh.
It's perfect. I don't have to worry about it. They just run and run forever. Right. You know, they're great. Like the U50, U150.
Of course, they got remote access anyway and all that good stuff. So.
You know, and it's a great way to mix and match. And choosing an edge of the network device is one of these things where you want to have kind of this whole inclusive plan for how you're going to attack it. And then as you move up, you can get these different premium packages, which will add spam protection, phishing, web filter, live support, of course. You can brand it, do failover stuff for WAN failovers, for
intrusion
internet connections.
Detection.
And if you want to grab one of these, use our code LAST20, it'll save you 20% on that service offering. It's really awesome. And by the way, if you're an educational customer, they've got discounts.
Nice.
These are great for schools. If you want to put little firewalls at different schools and things like that, want these appliances. I'm telling you, these things fit perfectly in the rack. I've even done things where I get a shelf and I'll put two firewalls with two different internet connections and they fit beautifully. They don't make any noise. Love them. Yes. And when you're in education, you even get a bigger discount. Use that code LAST20, save 20%, and go check out Untangle, the perfect marriage of the power of Linux with ease of use. Rule your network. Thanks to Untangle. All right, Matt.
All right.
So, Docker. Docker is very Ubuntu focused. I'm not going to lie. I was looking over here on their website. When you go to docker.io, they have a little get started link you can click on.
That's kind of handy.
And if you're on like 12.04 or 12.10, this is probably fine.
Sure.
Or if you're on Windows or OS 10, this is fine because they'll give you instructions for either one of those. However, if you're on Arch or Ubuntu 13.04, go down here and click on this more detailed instructions link that they have, and they'll have links for setting it up on EC2, Rackspace Cloud, Arch Linux, and Ubuntu 13.04. Now, because I already set it up on my machine, so that way I could show it to people.
Right.
I did record the process though, so I'm gonna walk you guys through setting it up. Yeah. And it's just as easy as you might expect. The first thing you do is if you're doing it on 13.04, you go over there and they provide you with repositories. The first thing you have to do, though, is you have to set up the AUFS file system support. This is that copy-on-write file system.
Right, yeah, just copy that in.
And it's already bundled in the 3.8 kernel, so just make sure you have the packages you need. There's a little command there that you'll go out and say, you've already got it or not. Then you add the PPA. Okay. adds the PPA to your repository, then you do an apt-get update like you would normally do. Once you've done that, you just install the LXE container package, mm-hmm. and it goes out and gets that, and you install Docker. And then, once you've done that, so to recap, you got the PPA, you do an update, mm-hmm. you install the packages they list here on their website. They've got all of the packages broken out, and you could just copy and paste if you wanted to.
Seems pretty straightforward so far.
So they've made a meta package called LXE-Docker. This is what's kind of nice about doing it on Ubuntu, is that pulls down a bunch of different depths for you. And that's a really nice advantage. Once you've done that, they have a basic command, and I just ran docker run interactive Ubuntu and then run bin bash. Now, because I didn't have this Ubuntu image on my system yet, Docker goes out and pulls it from the repository. You see there's the...
So it takes care... Okay, so it's pulling it down for
it's
you.
Pulling it down right now. Right. It's doing a checkout, and it will only pull down the components it needs to establish this environment. Now, because it's a 1204 or 1210, it's pretty different from my system, so it has to pull down a lot of files.
Sure, sure. But it's still okay. But it's still going to be pretty minimal,
and then
the
boom,
stuff it wants.
Bob's Drunkle, now I'm in. Look, see right here, I'm in that Ubuntu environment.
Oh, that's cool.
And it's a 1204 environment.
That's slick.
Yeah, it's really nice. So again, just to repeat, you go get the repos, you make sure you've got LUFS support, AUFS support installed, add the repo, and you're done. Arch, they've got repo for you. They've got a repo for you too. It's essentially the same process, just substitute your own tools in. When you're looking around on here, they also have links for Windows. Now I know Windows.
Yeah, it's like what? But you know, they offer.
Turns out we've actually got Windows users that watch the show. Actually,
okay.
About half.
Really? Well, then you guys will probably want to check this out.
So they use a technology you might be familiar with if you're a developer called Vagrant. Mm. And Vagrant will set up a virtual box set up on your machine, pull down images for you, mm-hmm. and get this rolling. It is not as ideal as running it natively on a Linux box, but think of it as like, okay, you spin up one VM, and then you can run all the stuff inside that one VM.
Okay, so there's still some virtualization happening
when
for
you
Windows,
do it on Windows
right.
or the Mac. Yeah.
Oh, Mac too. Okay,
yeah, it's the same process for that.
But at least it's doable. I mean, there's a method of doing it. It looks like it's got lots of pictures. Yeah.
So here's cool. a couple of bits of interest, and we'll have more links in the show notes, including some extra guides for you guys. Go to docs.docker.io to get started. That's where you'll find the how-to for your different distributions of choice. They've got a few unofficial guides too for Arch
nice.
And or I'm not for Fedora and OpenSUSE.
Oh, cool. Okay.
So those guys aren't left out as well.
Woo-hoo.
And in the show notes, I've linked the Arch guide, the Debian guide, and the link to the Ubuntu PPA. So you can find all of that in there. And as long as you have kernel 3.8 on the latest Ubuntu, you've got like 90% of the Linux-level technology that you need to do this. The container stuff's built in. Support for the file system's there. You just need a couple of extra bits of software. It's pretty awesome.
It's a real time saver. I like that.
It is. It's absolutely a time saver when you get rolling. So even if you're not a big Ubuntu user, if you just want to play with this and you want the native speed, just set aside an Ubuntu box to play with it, because that's what the Docker guys are using. They're branching out. They're already working on other support, but that's just where it's at right now.
Well, it's cool that they're also branching out to Arch and to Debian and whatnot. I think it's cool that they're embracing other distros, but it seems like, yes, their focus is definitely very Ubuntu-based. So, you know, just something to bear in mind.
Absolutely. So go check it out at docker.io.
And that brings us to the end of this week's broadcast. But Matt,
before we get out of here, we got some emails to cover.
Emails.
And I want to make a special announcement that next week, I think we'll do a gaming-heavy episode. And I got 6 games in my Steam library. I'm not going to necessarily give away all 6, but I'll probably give away most of them to the live audience. So
right on.
Show up live next Sunday at 10 a.m. Pacific over at jblive.tv, which means we can't get sick now.
That's
over at
right.
jblive.tv for a gaming edition of Linux Action Show. Yep. We'll recap some of the new games that came out. Also, help me discover some open source free games that we can talk about. Maybe start a thread in the subreddit and be our boots on the ground. And if somebody helps out,
that
might
be cool.
Some Reddit gold or a Steam game involved.
Could be something.
Yeah. So that'll be next week, and we'd love to have you here because it's just time to shoot some stuff.
Yes, absolutely. It's always time to shoot stuff. Should be.
All right, I want to cover some feedback we got. First one comes from Zspaceman. This is why Ubuntu really does need a new package management system. Remember we talked about the Click package management system?
Right.
This is on last. Chris and Matt had a meh reaction to the possibility of a new package format for Ubuntu. While it's important for Ubuntu to speed up the software center, because remember that's where our main gripe, the new system is a logical and necessary step. The only way for paid applications, open source and proprietary, to be submitted to Ubuntu is to submit your app as a tarball that gets extracted to /opt. Only free open source apps can hand off a deb or a PPA. So you know what would be awesome? Standardization. So let's make a system that handles free open source and paid apps the same. Let's at least talk about it on the mailing list, right? Which is what exactly what they're doing.
That's a fair argument. I hadn't really considered it because I wasn't aware of the submission process. So having that light shine.
Yeah, that's true. And he says, in his opinion, the current system just cannot scale. It relies too much on different processes that just aren't going to scale as they get bigger. And they need to standardize before developers are going to embrace this.
Yeah, that's true.
And, you know, I talked briefly about it with Michael Dominic on Coda Radio, and he's essentially had the same thing. It's like, you know, targeting for Ubuntu, there's all of these questions, and packaging is one of them.
Right.
And we'll see where they go with this. Now, on the flip side, Andrew writes in. He says, Ubuntu click packages are a poor idea. Hi, guys. Insert praise here. But with regards to Ubuntu's new packaging system, number one, applications do not already package their own libraries, at least not the ones shipped in Debian. Debian's policy is such that it is very hard for an application to ship with its own version of a library. The package maintainer usually takes care of this. And I was making comments that a lot of applications now ship with statically linked libraries.
Yeah.
I was speaking of proprietary applications that you download from the commercial vendor's website. Obviously, anything you pull in from your repo is using shared libraries.
Makes sense.
He said, the reason shared libraries is a good idea has nothing to do with disk space. It's security. Not that long ago, Microsoft had a vulnerability with one of its core libraries that every single Visual Studio application shipped with. That means that any application compiled with that version of or older of Visual Studio is today still vulnerable to the attack. I think it was a GDI issue in the call-out layout. Regardless, this can't happen with a Debian or Fedora today. If OpenSSL has a flaw and it's found, the distro ships a patched version, and every application that uses SSL is then patched. And this is absolutely the counter-argument.
That's an interesting argument as well. So I think that what we're going to be faced with is we're going to have to find a balance between security and getting stuff to the Ubuntu Software Center in a sane manner.
And I think what Andrew's getting at is kind of the nugget of why the click package debate is kind of an interesting debate, because you can see logical arguments for having it on Canonical's side, and then you can look at Andrew's email and you can see logical arguments to not have it.
And they're both really well stated. I mean, I can't say one is more right than the other. I think they're addressing different concerns.
Right.
And the security concern is an absolute, that's a problem. Mm-hmm. So if they can address the security concern and still have their cake and eat it too and come up with a way to get this stuff, it could happen.
Yeah.
But that's a very good, concern.
Well, and in some ways, the free market kind of works itself out in this, because if you're a vendor who's supplying me vulnerable software, I'm going to stop buying your software, stop using your software.
If you can identify it. Right.
But the word will spread.
It will.
Online. And it will behoove you to frequently patch.
Yeah.
And the App Store model makes that very simple. The repo model. All right.
This is true.
Next email comes in from Cousin. He says, hi there. On a recent last, you mentioned you could contact open source developers to pose a question that we might have in a feature request. And he lists us the link, and he says he wants us to talk to them about how they salt their passwords. And this isn't really – this question came in. Basically, he's asking us to go ask the project a question on behalf of him and report back. Not really a scalable use of the Linux Action Show, but I thought we would take this question and sort of flip it on its head and say – we would give him some advice on how he could interact with these projects to get the question.
There you go.
And he said that he's tried to contact them on their bug list, hasn't gotten a lot of feedback, tried reaching out to them on GitHub, not a lot of feedback. Mm-hmm. I would say it depends on your project. He was looking at Dispora.
Oh, okay. Right.
So I would say, you know, go find out if Dispora has an IRC chat room you can join, because usually you'll have a few devs idling in there to answer newbie questions. And sometimes you pose your question and maybe 10 minutes later you get an answer. Or go check to see if they have forums specifically. Each project has their own sort of community, you know, mechanisms.
So even though they might seem to, even though they may have IRC forums and all these other things, sometimes they kind of orbit around one central space, but maybe try the IRC. And that probably is going to be your best bet if they offer it.
I want to just do a follow-up email from Christoph. He writes in. He's that Mac user we read a few weeks back that was eyeballing Linux. He said, third email from me, the Mac user from Belgium. He says, just to let you know that I haven't missed one episode of Linux Action Show since I started watching.
Awesome.
After 14 years with the Fruity brand, I bought yet another Mac a couple of weeks ago. Remember, we talked about that? The plan was to run Linux, and it's working out quite well in VirtualBox. I'm yearning for more, so instead of a used ThinkPad T61, I'll be buying a brand new laptop after all to run Linux.
Right on.
He says, I'm going to continue experimenting on several different distros in VirtualBox. He's found Linux Mint, and so far Cinnamon has been his initial favorite.
That's interesting. Okay.
He said at the end it lost out to OpenSUSE and KDE, because if Matt puts it, the granular control it offers. I thought as a Mac user is finding KDE, he's loving this. As a Linux noob, I see KDE as a graphical extension of the command line, i.e. it's powerful and gives you control over a huge number of aspects of your desktop environment. And if you're going for KDE, you might as well choose the best implementation of it. And I kind of like the OpenSUSE implementation. He says, going on reading ahead here, as always, keep up the good work. You never know, might even make a switch from iOS to Android one day.
Wow.
P.S. He hasn't forgotten about the chocolates, but wants to know where those numbers are on Steam.
Well, and I can tell you that on making the switch from iOS to Android, I've done it myself. I've actually helped a few other people here over the past couple of weeks do it, and everybody that I've helped do it, make that switch, has not regretted it. They're actually saying, oh, the reaction, a common reaction, you can do that with a smartphone. Hmm. That's the number one reaction I get with anyone that switches over to Android.
All right.
Yeah. That was mine.
Well, a lot of vendors like the HTC One are making their interface very smooth for people moving from iOS. So,
and one of the forget which phone, but they have like a newbie interface, like a newbie option. Or
hey, Sam, my Note offers that.
Yeah, and it's great because it's like a kind of a gateway drug. You know?
Yeah, there's like a, if I'm using the standard Note, the one that ships with the Note, there's like an easy mode or something.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's cool. And that's cool. So, I mean, that way you're not overwhelmed and you can kind of get used to your experience and then, you know, branch out from there.
That's a good point. So Ralph wrote in and they said, hey guys, I really enjoyed your show about the potential Dropbox killers last week. However, I have a question about AeroFS.
Okay.
Oh, this is interesting. Matt said that he got it to work on OpenSUSE without much ado, but this is my issue. When I try to run it on either Fedora or OpenSUSE, it just won't auto start. Is there a simple way to do this? If so, please share. Dropping the command line to manually run it gets a bit old after a while.
There was, and if I remember correctly, dropping it in the auto start folder didn't work, and I did something specific to OpenSUSE. I believe there is, and OpenSUSE guys, help me out here because I forget, because it's not in front of me. There's actually a GUI for auto starting in OpenSUSE, and I think that's where I did it, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh yeah, in the in Yast.
Yes, I think it's in Yast. Yeah, I'm trying to remember exactly what they call it, but
so well, I guess what Ralph could do is that it's kind of funny that it didn't auto start for him. But what Ralph could do is he could go to the command line here, right?
No,
he could probably do /help, and okay.
Yeah,
so there's arrowfs-cli to see what the different interfaces are, because you know on my Ubuntu box I'm still using it.
Yeah, and I have it installed on my OpenSUSE. But yeah, I'd say that's, you know, as far as a GUI solution, it's in Yast. I forget, and you may even have to Google exactly what it's called if you don't see it in Yast immediately, but it is possible. Auto start in KDE doesn't always work with everything I found.
So. I have a plea for the Linux Action Show audience.
Okay.
So this is my feedback email that I sent. Dear Matt and Chris, could you help me find an application for Linux? I would like a really good soundboard to run on Linux, kind of like Ambrosia Soundboard for the Mac, where you have essentially a list of you have banks of rows of clips, and they're all hotkeyed by numbers and letters.
Oh, that would be
and
nice.
If it's the active window, all you have to do is reach over and you just press a button on the keyboard, and that sound triggers. This seems like such a obvious thing that should be out there in open source, and I cannot find any of them that is just a straight up play clips.
Like, or if one of you guys wants to make one, that'd be cool too. Just saying.
Yeah. But if you guys know of one that is close to Ambrosia Soundboard as possible, I would love to know about it. Email the show, linuxactionshow@jupiterbroadcasting.com, or hit that contact link or start a thread in our subreddit. Mm-hmm. Help me here, people, because I'm using this on a Mac, the soundboard when I use, and it's killing me. But it is very nice. It's got a lot of nice features, and I don't need like half of them. I mean, like some of the features are really like you can clip in the app and that's really cool, but I would just really like to be able to hotkey my
sound. Seems pretty reasonable.
Yeah.
Totally. I'm just asking.
So if you guys out there know of one, please do let me know. Matt, what are you up to?
As always, you can find me at datamation.com. Scroll down to Open Source. You'll find me there.
You got a Chromium versus Firefox article up recently.
I did.
Look at you.
Oh, yes.
Very
and
nice.
Also did a here coming up here pretty soon. I got a Windows versus Ubuntu, which that'll be interesting. It's kind of gliding over the surface. It's not like every single aspect of it, but you know, kind of touches on some stuff.
Yeah, you're such a crowd pleaser.
I'm gonna get grief either way, so it doesn't matter.
Don't forget, we have links to both our social network profiles on Twitter and Google+ and Facebook in the show notes. And the Linux Action Show was live 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. UTC, I think.
Sounds right.
Might be 5 p.m. I don't know. Join us live next week, and you might get yourself a Steam giveaway. I'm handing out Steam games like a madman.
Woo!
Give them away.
Line all
Crazy Chris is blowing them out, man. Crazy Chris.
Don't even want to know where they're coming out of.
We'll be shooting stuff next week, too, so don't forget we want to hear your game suggestions.
Yep.
And the subreddit would be the best spot. That way other people can be like, yeah, I played that game. Do that rock!
Exactly. And we'll be able to see it, too. You know, that's a big thing.
All right, everyone. Thanks so much for tuning in this week's episode of the Linux Action Show. We'll see you right back here next week.
Hey, Matt. Hey, chat room.
You.
La, la, la. La, 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 la. Do you know about it?